Tonight, I'm very pleased to present you with David Hannon of Fisher Architects. And they specialize in heritage projects. And he was very lucky. He had mentioned to me that he was interested in someday having a rammed earth structure of his own. That was a dream of his. So he knew that was an interest of mine, and I knew that that was a dream of his. And then one day he told me that he had this project, which I didn't know that there were any half timber frame structures with adobe infill, and he found one. Or his clients.
Oh, we did find.
Yeah. The clients found him, I guess. Right. So he's going to tell us about that tonight. So I'm going to hand it over to David.
Well, thank you all for having me, and it's a really great pleasure to be here. Thanks to Loranne for the invitation. I hope you guys enjoy this little project of ours. So, as Loranne said, my name is David Hannon. I'm with Fisher Architects. A little bit about me. I was born and raised in Houston suburbs. Went to school at Texas Tech University. I've worked for a really large firm in Park Hill Smith & Cooper, and I've also worked for a little bitty firm of three people at Halo Architects. I'm currently a principal at Fisher Heck Architects here in San Antonio, and I primarily at the firm work on basically anything old. It's kind of a way to put it. And like Loranne said, I'm really fascinated with rammed earth construction. I did my thesis on a rammed earth eco lodge in Sundown, Texas. So that's kind of where it all started for me. A little bit about our firm. We were established in 1982 by Louis Fisher and Jim Heck. We're a 10-person firm. We primarily work on historic buildings, but we also do a lot of religious work, and we do a lot of educational projects as well. And our kind of mantra is designing community, and that's goes to kind of the projects that we work on. A lot of the projects deal primarily with community-focused solutions, and so we don't do a lot of private or corporate work, and so that's kind of where our focus is right now. And so every now and again we do get really interesting little projects. A homeowner out of Denver, Colorado decided to move down here, retire, and they found this piece of property up in the Cordillera Ranch development in Bernie, Texas. And they kind of stumbled upon it accidentally, not knowing or not looking for an historic building to restore or anything like that. They're primarily looking to build a new house on a vacant lot. But the client saw this out of the corner of his eye and basically fell in love with it. And they ended up purchasing the property and then hiring us to help them restore it. So this is kind of a outline of the property right now. If you're not familiar with Cordillera Ranch, a lot of the properties are about 3 to 5 acres, so it's really spread out. I think their property is right under four acres. But what makes their property unique is that they sit on this bluff within the development and overlooks this really great, you know, kind of ravine down here. And then they've got a neighbor right here that they're looking to maybe share the adjacent lot with. So we'll see if that comes to fruition. A little bit of background on the property itself. We believe it was constructed in 1861 by a German immigrant named Eugene Volker. He and his wife had about 5 children, and they ended up purchasing about 320 acres at the time. And then a year after Eugene's death, his oldest child, Anna, married a man named Caspar Solnfuss, and they ended up building this house along with some other support structures for ranching and everything like that. And then Caspar actually operated the house as a post office for a brief time, and so that's kind of what we refer to it right now as the post office. And so presently, the development was currently using it as kind of a recreation center until they built their brand new one about a year ago. And so it was filled with canoes and fishing rods and all kinds of, you know, kind of junk stuff. And it really wasn't being well kept or well maintained. Part of our scope of the project was to get the project on the National Register of Historic Places as well as a Texas landmark. And so we were able to achieve that, but it was a very kind of unique process, and we'll get into that a little later. And so right now the historic structure is just this piece right here. We believe a kind of secondary dog trot structure was built in the 1980s adjacent to it, but it was built to really mimic the existing structure, as you can see, and they did a really pretty good job of it. It's not adobe infill though, but I think they really wanted to tie the two structures together. And so here's a photo of the south facade of the house. For whatever reason, the plaster either wasn't applied to this wall or it was taken off for some reason. We don't really know at this point. But you can kind of see the current condition of the adobe block. And right here on the edge, on the corner of the building, there used to be a doorway. And at some point, they filled it in, probably not appropriately. And I think due to wind-driven rain, the adobe block has started to kind of slurry and kind of mold together, and the bricks are kind of becoming unstable. And so part of our work is to, you know, replace this with all new adobe block, hopefully with the same, utilizing the same material that's already there, just reforming bricks out of it. On the inside, all the walls are completely exposed adobe, and this was a real selling point for the client because he really, really loves this stuff. You can kind of see the scratch marks of, you know, the trowel and the plaster and how it was applied. And so somewhere along the way, someone sprayed or applied some kind of sealer to the adobe block, and so it's got this really glossy sheen to it. We're gonna try to see if we can gently scrape that off. It's not something we're too thrilled about. A lot of things like this building, things were kind of thrown at it and hoping it would, you know, stick and help maintain the building. The plaster on the exterior is not the original plaster. It's actually a cementous, Portland cement plaster. And so we're gonna try to take that off and apply lime plaster to help the walls breathe a little bit better. Right now the cement plaster is trapping moisture in, and that's kind of eating away at a lot of the wood structure. So hopefully we can salvage that. You can kind of see the rough-hewn planks up here in the ceiling and how some of them were white. There's a fireplace right here that currently doesn't work very well. And at some point, a lot of soot and smoke got into the ceiling, and so a lot of the ceiling is completely black. And so I think they, at some point, painted the board's white to try to lighten it up, I guess. And so we're gonna try to, you know, scrape that off and refinish the ceiling as best we can. But this is just a fun picture we took, just because of the deer here. But one of the one of the stipulations or one of the comments we got from the Texas Historical Commission was they didn't want any of the adobe plaster to be exposed in order to get the tax credit. So, because they believe, probably rightfully so, that it wasn't originally exposed, it was probably plastered on both sides. But the owner really loves the look of the adobe block, and so we were able to convince THC to just keep the adobe in this central living space, but we'll plaster everything else. So here's kind of a existing floor plan of the existing structure, as well as the 1980s addition here. We don't believe this is the original footprint of the building. It was probably, just this rectangular area with maybe a wraparound porch. But it's a very simple layout, and for the most part, we're not going to really modify too much of it. Most of the new work is going to come with these two bedroom additions. And so here's kind of a floor plan of what the proposed layout is going to be. We're going to enlarge this kind of central patio space and have a Corten steel arbor across it. And so the idea is to have a lot of late night dinners out there, drinking wine and looking at the stars. And then we've got two identical bedrooms. And the owner plans to live in here once it's finished, and then build their new house on the same property. That's still in development. Okay. And so here's kind of a layout of what they plan to do. So here's the existing structures. And one of the other stipulations with the Texas Historical Commission was any new house had to be at least 100 feet away from the existing property. So thankfully it's a large lot. We were able to accommodate that. So here's our 100-foot line. They also didn't want the new house to be any taller than the existing building. And so we were able to accommodate that as well. That's pretty much it in a nutshell. I'll be glad to answer any questions you guys might have. Yes.
Yeah. How thick is the adobe?
It's only one length thick, so it's not double layered or anything like that.
But are those timbers? Those are cedar timbers.
I believe so. Yes.
So are they? Is it like 5 inches, 8 inches? I couldn't tell.
It's about somewhere between 5 and 6, I would say.
Do the walls provide any thermal benefit to the building as they stand right now?
Well, right now, that's the hope, is to have the plaster apply some relief with air penetration. So right now, it is relatively comfortable in there. And we are providing a new air conditioning system within the house. It'll be a VRF system, and so it won't have any ductwork or anything like that. We'll have floor standing units that will provide air into all three structures.
Are you using like a native lime plaster to do on the exterior?
Yes. Yep.
What's the current makeup of the roof? And what are you doing to modify anything?
So the current makeup of the roof, and you saw it in one of the other photos, there's large rough-hewn planks of wood that are sitting on rafters, and then on top of that there's, we think it's a wood shingle roof, and then somewhere on top of that they applied a standing seam metal roof. The plan is to remove the standing seam metal roof, partly because the front porch is in really bad condition. And we're gonna evaluate the condition of the wood shake roof But the goal is to possibly remove that, apply new plywood and a new moisture and air barrier, and then apply a new standing seam metal roof on top. Something a little bit more appropriate to style the house, so it won't have these eave or these hip covers. We'll have folded standing seams at the eaves and at the ridge.
But any rigid insulation above the deck or anything like that?
Yep.
Is that because it's not historically appropriate?
Right. Yeah, we didn't want to get the, we didn't want to make the roof, you know, so thick that it would alter the overall look of the house.
Are the foundations of the two structures similar? I mean, was there any attempt made in the 80s on the second structure to mimic the foundation as well, or is it purely cosmetic issues?
I think the foundations are pretty similar. This one, I think, is I think they're both pier and beam, and they've both got a stone foundation beam around it. Somewhere along the way, they poured a concrete porch in the front here, and we're gonna basically take that off and do a new wood frame porch, and then we're not gonna have the baluster across it, so it'll be a lot more open.
So the original house that had the wood siding, that was meant?
That was this one. We think at one point, in an attempt to make the house a little bit more dignified, if you go back to that old slide, yeah, you can see the columns have a little bit of ornamentation to them. They got the and then there's a newer addition that was on back here, and so we think, and you can see how kind of dressed up everybody is, and so we think it was an attempt to kind of dignify the house a little bit more and make it a little bit more formal or traditional, rather than just maybe like a ranch house.
Showing off their horses that they rode.
Yep.
So that first picture is the lady from Evans. And so at some point, did they deconstruct that and replace it with this rough hewn material?
No, I think since I think the plaster and the brick were always there, I think they just put the boards on top, just to reclad it, basically.
I'd like to commend you because that's a very interesting project. It's very historical and it's like chile con carne. It's a blend of Mexican and German architecture. Flocker is what that system is called, but they're using Mexican style adobes because that's what they had around here.
Right.
My question is, do you know where the soil came from?
That's our assumption. They probably wouldn't have ventured out or purchased anything from far away. But our guess is that they used something around the ranch. They have 320 acres, so it's probably something on their land.
Does it have significant clay content?
We don't know.
Typically, caliche.
Mm-hmm.
And the addition was done in the 1890s or
1990s. And so it's a wood framed structure, but it's also got the half timber exposed flock work as well, but there's no adobe in between it.
So the adobes are only the width of the timbers. So were they just made in a, do you know if they were actually made in a form that was that size, or were they like larger adobes that they split in half, or is there any?
I don't think they were modified. I think they were just formed to the width of the timbers and then basically just used as insulation.
The mortar was just the same material?
Yes,
remember they had a white material on. Is that fungus or is that old paint?
Okay.
It's probably a mixture of a lot of things. There's also a lot of orange spray foam insulation in some of the joints. So I tried to spare you guys.
Give it to them, man. They need a, like a full dose of how the world works.
Yeah, I mean, so
buy the can and fill the hole.
Yeah.
Is there like a porch or an overhang that isn't like part of the main part that you could preserve the original shingles on and show what they look like? It wouldn't matter if it leaked. I mean, you could. You wouldn't have a huge. It was just sort of
right.
Gather the good ones that still late and maybe play them.
Yeah, the only porch we have is this front one, and we actually tried to convince THC to go with a wood shingle roof, and they actually kind of balked at that. They said, "Well, we only have photographic evidence of standing seam metal roof, so that's what we want you to go back with."
That sounds about like the tax credit.
Yeah.
I've worked with them before. My question is, you mentioned that section, I think it's probably on the front porch, where they like moved the door and did some bad infill and you've got to redo the adobe. Is there interest in some of that that's broken down, testing it to see what that kind of composition was to figure out more about where they might have gotten the materials to?
Yeah, I think the owner would definitely be open to something like that, and I'll definitely, you know, make that suggestion that,
yeah,
you know.
Come back and tell us about it.
Sure. And the client is very kind of proud of this building, and he likes to kind of show it off to people, so he would be more than willing to have visitors to the building if there's any interest in it.
Field trip.
So what's your timeline, project timeline? Like, how long is it, are you thinking it's going to take for the restoration of the main house?
So the building is currently being priced right now by James Nolan Construction, and we've submitted the plans back to THC with a few modifications. Mainly, they wanted to see the design of the new house, and so that it took some time for that to be developed first, and then so right now we anticipate construction starting hopefully around August, and it'll probably take maybe 6 to 9 months to construct. So.
So since now it's already designated on THC, the fact that you are gonna put AC, that's completely gonna damage the adobe. Where you like the moisture that's gonna be because of the climate. I mean, we have that problem in many of the historic buildings in San Antonio, where now there's HVAC and that damaging heater of the structure. With that, is there going to be a treatment or something kind of to prevent that?
Well, it's got a sealer on there now, and like I said, we're going to try to take that off and try to find maybe a replacement sealer that isn't as glossy. Mm-hmm. And the building actually currently has air conditioning in it right now, and so that's definitely one of our concerns, but it's something that we're gonna definitely look into.
On your one of your pictures, it seems like there was some kind of metal mesh or something on the wall, but from here that's what it looked like.
Was it one of the porch?
Yeah, is that what that you're trying to remove right now off of the adobe, or?
Well, the front porch facade actually has a little bit of metal left still installed.
Okay.
From either they put that up and attempt to put plaster on, or it was left over from the plaster that was taken off. We're not sure at this point.
I'm just curious also on concerning that he was asking about the soil and so forth. Have you been able to just make any your personal like touch or feel in the original adobes? Do they sink? Do they dust? Do they crumble?
No, because of the sealer. I mean, it feels really slick almost.
Slick?
Yeah, it's like a slick coating that's on the brick right now. So that's part of the issue that we're dealing with.
Is that just on the inside?
Yeah. Or just inside?
It's on both sides. So I think it was something that they, you know, just threw on there to preserve what they had.
Because of the dusting.
Right.
How long do you think it's been there?
It's junk.
It's probably shellac.
Has the sealer been there for a long time?
It's hard to say. Probably since the development purchased the entire property, so I'd say probably less than 10 years.
Does it appear to be delaminating or?
Not currently.
So the right people, the Cordillo Ranch did it?
Yeah, that's our assumption.
Okay.
Of course, they won't tell us.
Yeah.
If it was built that long ago before air conditioning came, they probably laid it out so that the breeze would go right through. And would it be possible to use fans and avoid somewhat air conditioning?
Well, the hope is that they don't have to turn the air conditioning on. And it's mainly going to be there as a convenience, not something that they're going to rely on. And the house isn't going to be used by them once the new house is purchased on a full-time basis. And so that'll definitely help. Part of the process of getting the tax credits was the property has to be used as a revenue generator. And so technically they have to lease out the property or rent it out for as a B&B or something like that, you know, at least once a year. And so that's I think what their plan is right now.
I'm curious about the interface between the timber sections and the adobe sections. Is it bonding well? Can you tell if anything was done to, or are you, it sounds like in the future you're just relying on the plaster to take care of any air gaps, but what kind of condition is the actual interface in between the timbers and the adobes?
Well, right now it's completely butting up against the timber structure, and there's it's really just the soil mortar, for lack of a better term, that's in between there.
And it seems to be competent still, but even
mm-hmm.
on the older structure?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the other than the, you know, this corner here on the building, the rest of the adobe structure is in pretty good condition. The timber structure itself is actually in the worser condition.
So just to summarize the construction, the timber framing was all built in, and then they just put the adobe bricks in between the timbers.
Right.
And used the local soil as a mortar or whatever. Nobody's ever investigated like a soils map or geologic area of the area to say, yeah, the soil might come up from over here.
We haven't had a study like that done right now.
Most probably from the site, would be my guess.
And walking around and seeing where there's good leaching or good clay material and see what sticks to your leg. And
there's a creek down there.
Exactly.
Yeah,
yeah.
They
had 320 acres, so I'm sure it came from somewhere nearby.
It's great to see it with an adobe, though. We've only ever seen it with a straw plate type of an infill from the German history, I guess, to see them meld those two together.
Do you know of any other buildings, similar typology in this region, or is this the one-off?
This is the first that we've seen. I mean, I would assume there would be more, but this
we have a number of them up in Mason.
Yeah.
Adobe infill?
I don't know if they're Adobe infill, but they've got that same timber frame, the softer type of design. They've been abused, you know. They've had cement stucco put on them and paint put over top of them. And I'm just amazed that they're still standing with the abuse that those old buildings are experiencing with our modern cement.
Right. Yes.
Yeah, I just had a question on the timbers, because you said they were in worse shape. Is it, how are you going to preserve those? Or?
But right now we're going to look at it as a, on a, basically a timber by timber basis. We're going to try to leave it up to the carpenter who's going to be working on the project to determine, you know, whether each piece is going to be salvageable or not. So the hope is that we don't have to replace any, but I'm sure there's going to be one or two that we're going to have to.
You know, originally, the front where you would see the timbers, it would be exposed.
Right.
And that makes it very attractive, actually.
Yep.
It's not really building related, but is CJ and Volker related to the Volkers that end the area that's now Hardberger Park?
We believe it's the same family. I mean, they had Eugene was part of a large family, and then he and his wife also had a large family. So we believe that they're the same. They're related.
On your other historic preservation work that you guys have done, what other situations have you seen where adobes are? Earthen-based materials have been covered with a cementitious type of stucco on the exterior. What other type of problems have you seen outside of anything that's on this project in your experience so far in the San Antonio and Hill Country area?
Well, this is our first adobe project, so we're by no means experts on this type of construction. We're primarily used to masonry buildings that have been either plastered over or so we see a lot of that. We just recently restored a courthouse down in Karn City that had been completely plastered over for a more modern look. And so,
is that adobe?
No, it's all brick and stone. Brick and stone is about 95% of the material that we're used to addressing.
How did you get that off?
It's very carefully chiseled off. But since it was cement based, it actually came off really easily. It came off in large sheets. So.
And that was over a limestone brick?
No, it was over. It was over just. It wasn't limestone brick, I don't believe. But it was over brick and a really soft sandstone.
Okay, before y'all go away, I just wanted to remind you that we always have room for more ECI members. So please consider joining our group and becoming a member of ECI, and you'll we'll make sure that we'll keep sending you notifications for more members presents and also future programs that we will be expanding once we get to a little bit further down the road. These would include educational courses, training classes, and that sort of thing as well.
I have membership forms, so I'll leave them up here on the table.
Yeah. So we're all set for you.